Welcome to the Luxury Listing Specialist Podcast with Michael LaFido, where top luxury agents reveal their best practices, plus interviews with real estate industry influencers, thought leaders, and luxury marketing experts. You'll come away from each episode with new strategies and tactics to dominate high-end homes in any market. And now for the latest episode of Luxury Listing Specialist. Here's your host, luxury real estate expert, coach, and trainer, Michael LaFido.
Welcome back to another episode of the Luxury Listing Specialist podcast. You're listening to the right podcast, whether you're a beginning agent, a mid-level agent, or you're a rock star agent, and you're just looking for the principal edge to just not just to attract more high-end opportunities, more luxury listings, but perhaps you have that high-end listing, that difficult listing, and you want to get more eyeball traffic, and you're looking for that slight edge, maybe a strategy, something you haven't thought about. And that's what we're all about. We continue. Please share with us any feedback or any suggestions that you have for other topics. Again, I'm your host, Michael LaFido. You can send me an email to michael@marketingluxurygroup.com, michael@marketingluxurygroup.com. I'm really excited about today's guest, but before I go into that, don't forget we're on iTunes, we're on Stitcher. Please leave us a review, or you can go to luxurylistingpodcast.com to listen to previous episodes. All right, today I'm really excited. I have the president of Luxury Portfolio International with me, Stephanie Anton. Stephanie, are you there?
I'm here. Hi, Michael.
Thank you for your time. Stephanie and I, we run into each other at a lot of these conferences just a few weeks back. We were at the Inman Luxury Conference, and I was able to pin her down to be on the show, and I really appreciate it. I know you have a lot of responsibilities, so thank you for your time.
Oh, I'm happy to do it. Thank you for asking me.
Can you tell the audience a little bit about Luxury Portfolio International and for not just for clarification purposes, but just a little bit about, you know, leading real estate companies of the world and then the luxury component of that?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So leading real estate companies of the world is our parent organization, and it's a collection of independently branded brokerages in over 60 countries. So they're all local brands like At Properties. They're all have a lot of market share. They're well known in their market. They have a great reputation, and then they're committed to really doing business with one another. And so the companies that are part of Leading RE, which is what we call it for short, have to qualify for membership, and the membership is at the brokerage level. We do have multiple members in a market generally, but we've been around for actually 50 years. We used to be called RELO, and then about 15 years ago, we rebranded to Leading RE, and the network now, you know, I think we're almost about 600 brokerages. And it's all, sizes. I mean, it's larger brokers, but it's about market share. And so it can be a broker that is in a smaller market. They just have to have a significant part of the market share in that smaller market. So we have companies that have 7 agents that might be focused on one boutique market. And then we have companies that have 15,000 agents. So all sizes, and then all sorts of things that we offer them, very similar to a franchise, but not the branding. That's the one piece of it that we don't offer. We're really about broker-to-broker referrals. One of the programs we offer is called Luxury Portfolio, and so it's a luxury marketing program that are for select members of Leading RE. And so today, Luxury Portfolio is about 250 brokerages, and they're companies that really focus on the high end. And it's only available to members that are part of Leading RE. It's available at the brokerage level, and it's a benefit that has a wide breadth of services, everything from a website to marketing services to listing presentation assistance to research analytics and insight into what's happening in the global luxury market, which I think is a little bit what we're going to talk about today.
Absolutely. No, that's great insight. I appreciate that. And so for the listeners, you know, everybody defines luxury differently. It's all relative to the given marketplace. But how does Luxury Portfolio International define luxury? In other words, for these 250-plus companies that belong, when they put on a listing in their given marketplace at you know, a certain price point. At what price point? Is it all based on region, or do you guys just define it flat across the board at a certain dollar amount?
Yeah, it's a very good question, because luxury is different in every market. Certainly $1 million in, you know, Chicago or Cleveland is going to buy you something more than $1 million in Orange County or San Francisco or Paris. So we do have to have a price point, obviously, for the website. So we have set that at $1 million US, because we can't manage realistically a different threshold for 60 different countries around the world. But we do have a quality assurance sort of component of it. So it's a little bit what makes Luxury Portfolio different is that the listings get submitted and then we look at each one of them physically. We have a group of human beings, I would say, that look at every listing and they ensure that it is really, you know, our best foot forward collectively. And even if it's $1.5 million, if it's $1.5 million in San Francisco, well, generally that would come on the market and sell before it would even make it to our website. But if it does, but it's, you know, really not what we would consider luxury, i.e. A great-looking listing, it won't make it on the site. So there's a couple. It's a price point, but it's also quality.
Well, that's great to hear, and that's really what we're all about with the podcast, is raising the bar, raising the standard for agents that, of course, benefits the consumers. So it's great to hear that you guys offer the quality assurance.
I think that's a big piece of it. I mean, at the end of the day, the consumer has an expectation, and so if they're looking for a listing in, you know, Switzerland and Italy and then Miami, they expect to have complete sentences. They expect to have, you know, details. They expect to have at least 5 photos. And, you know, it's hard to believe that that's raising the bar. But when we first launched the site 10 years ago, we said from day one, you have to have at least 5 photos. And we won't even take a listing if it doesn't. So it's because the consumer demands it.
Yeah, so it's interesting you bring that up. Several years ago when I was presenting at a conference, you know, I'm always looking for the principal edge, so I go over to the various vendors and pick their brain a little bit. And at the time, I got to imagine it's still the case, but at Realtor.com, one of their you know, their internal data points they shared with me is, you know, if a home's got more photos, you're going to get more clicks and more views. Do you find that to be true and on your website?
Absolutely. Yeah, no question. I mean, we certainly see, you know, some people that just send us the minimum and then some people that send us, you know, the maximum. And, well, there is no maximum. You can send us as many photos as you have. And then when we analyze specific markets, you can see that the properties that have more photography, you know, people spend more time on the listing. They get more clicks. They get more interest. And particularly if the photography is high res and good quality, if they have other enhancements like videos or tours or, you know, a Matterport tour, we find that there's a much higher engagement with that inventory than there is with, you know, just the MLS remarks. And I always call it agent speak, not English. And, you know, when we say 2/2, people don't, you know, necessarily know what that is. So we have to always keep that in mind.
Oh, that's good. On a totally different topic, and if you can't answer due to perhaps, you know, vendor relations, I get it. But based on, you know, photography, what are your thoughts on video versus 3D walkthrough tours? So I'm not saying Matterport directly, but similar type services. If you had a recommendation for agents based on engagement on your sites, are you seeing video to be, you know, more consumer friendly, or these 3D walkthrough type services?
Yeah. I mean, I think the interesting videos are the ones that are doing something different. They're telling a story. And I think the 3D walkthrough, they're cool. I think you kind of need to do both. I wouldn't say that those are necessarily, you know, mutually exclusive. It sort of depends on the property and the market. I think if you're trying to appeal, if you're in Manhattan, for example, and you've got a lot of buyers that are coming from around the world that potentially are never even going to visit the property, they're just going to look at it online, the more, you know, intel you have on it, the more you can share on it, the better. But I, you know, I really like the newer property videos that are more produced and they're telling a story. They're not just, you know, the agent walking to the house explaining everything. they're giving a sense of what it feels like to live in the home and the emotional aspects of the home rather than just the data points.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, so you have, you know, the old school videos, which are really photos that scan back and forth, and they create a video out of it. That's, you know, that's, you know, it's better than doing nothing. But what
well,
you're talking
right. Yeah,
about
in full disclosure, we do those, and yeah. I mean they're old school, but to your point, they are better than nothing, and yeah. They're at least, you know, it gives us an opportunity to produce a little. We call it a Lux tour.
Yep.
Gives us an opportunity to put it on YouTube to get greater exposure,
sure.
But
yep.
By no means is that something that we suggest is a video. That's a different animal altogether.
Yeah, it is. We could spend an hour on best practices and that sort of thing, but
yeah.
But video, what I will tell the listeners is video is not a fad. Fads come and go. Video's here to stay, so you really got to get on that video train, so to speak, to showcase the homes, and there's various ways to do that. You're not just showcasing the brick and mortar, but the location and telling, like Stephanie said, the story, and many times we're seeing
yeah.
many agents incorporate seller narration where they're sitting down with the owner and splicing in some of the audio clips where, you know, you're pushing on those emotional buttons.
Agree, 100%.
So we were talking a little bit offline, and one of the things I always tell agents is be a student of the game, right? For trends, what's trending, what's not trending, getting different perspectives of things. And you guys put together some amazing data and amazing research. Would you mind sharing, we were talking offline a little bit about a recent white paper that you guys put together?
Yeah, sure. We do. We've always done lots of research, and it's been a big component of what we do because I'm a big believer that when you sell luxury, it's not, you know, like I said, just the data points. You're selling a lifestyle, and it's not something people need, so you need to understand that. And so having insight into the hearts and minds of the affluent consumer is critical for understanding how to play in this marketplace. So we partnered 10 years ago with a company called YouGov, and they have authored papers for us twice a year. And so we do a global report, and then we do a specialty report. The global report always comes out in the fall, and the specialty report sort of in the early spring, right around the time of our conference. So the one we recently rolled out was called Luxury Real Estate, What Matters Most to Today's Global Elite. And it's cool because through YouGov, we can talk to affluent consumers. In this case, I think it was 14 countries. We talked to the top, you know, 10% and the top 1% of people in those markets and ask them, how are you feeling about real estate? What's important to you today? And we make it available. So, you know, not a plug, but just so your listeners know, they can visit luxuryportfolio.com. And if you scroll down on the homepage, you'll see where you can register to have that white paper. And we'll just email you the entire PDF. It's about 16 pages. It's not light. You have to really, I think, enjoy data or this space. But it's always a good temperature on what's happening with the global marketplace and, to your point, trends. And I'm always surprised. There's always things that we find in the paper that I didn't necessarily expect.
That's great. That's great. I appreciate that. So we'll include in the email promo for this podcast the link, luxuryportfolio.com. And as Stephanie mentioned, just scroll down and you'll find on there, maybe we'll do a screenshot to make it real easy for folks or something along those lines. But make sure you check that out. 16
I'm happy
pages
to give you, though, a couple of the sort of top takeaways just so people can get a sense.
Yes,
of,
please.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
I mean, you don't have to go there to read the whole thing. I mean, truly, it's
the Cliff Notes version, I guess. Remember in
Cliff
school,
notes.
They used to have the Cliff Notes. There you go.
I'll give you three things, right? So
perfect.
First is that we track the global high net worth real estate intentions. So their intention to buy or their intention to sell. And we've been doing that for 3 years. And what we found was this year, we talked to these very affluent people and say, you know, in the next 3 years, are you planning to buy or sell? And about 40% of them said, I'm planning to buy. And only 23% of them said, we're planning to sell. So still, that's a quarter of them. But, you know, it shows you that there's still a strong demand and interest among the high net worth for buying real estate. And that's great news, I think. There's a lot of reasons for that, but a big part of that is because of the strong growth we're seeing in the global high net worth. And you see that, you know, this group of people is only continuing to get wealthier and wealthier, and they love real estate, and we know that. So what we did in the paper was we broke it down by region. So we looked at North America, Europe, Middle East, and Asia to determine what the interest in buying was versus selling in each of those regions across the world. And in every region, buying was higher than selling. And then the disparity changed by region. So globally, the average was 38% wanted to buy, 23% wanted to sell. And the U.S. was kind of close to that. Europe was a little bit close to that. But the interesting part was the Middle East and Asia, because we see the Middle East, 70%, 71% looking to buy, 63% looking to sell. So very, very active luxury real estate market. And then Asia, interestingly, 68% looking to buy, only 18% looking to sell. And also not surprising if you understand, you know, it's all of Asia, not just China, but if you understand this consumer and how wealthy they're getting and how much interest they have in buying, you know, in their region, but also outside of the region. So I think that's a big measure about the opportunity with Asian buyers around the world for primary homes, but also secondary and tertiary homes.
Yeah, that sounds like secondary and in some cases maybe third or fourth homes.
Definitely, yep.
Good data.
Hey there, it's Michael LaFido. Thanks again for listening to our podcast. If you are interested in signing up for our Luxury Listing Specialist certification, or if you want additional information on how you can dominate selling higher-end homes in your marketplace, make sure you go to luxurylistingspecialist.com.
Anything else on that white paper?
I mean, I could talk to you for an hour about it, but I think one of the other things were we talk about the impact of personalization and how we asked people what makes a house a home, and because it's just, that's a very distinct difference when people use that language. This is my home versus this is just a house and shelter, uh-huh. And we see that it really is very connected to how settled people feel. And so if people are in a place where they know they're going to put down roots and stay, and they can customize their home and make it something that they really see reflects themselves and their family, that's when something becomes a home. But if they're looking for something that's temporary, or, you know, maybe it's a divorce, or it's a, you know, a transfer, or they don't see it as a place that they're going to stay for a long time, they just never really connect to it in an emotional level, even at the luxury side. So I think understanding some basic things like that. So for your listeners, you know, understanding the motivations for why someone's buying or selling can affect the language you use.
Yeah, that's a great point. I literally came from a conference yesterday, and they were talking about emotional intelligence and just, you know, being empathetic and having great listening skills to figure out their why, right? Why are they selling, right? And then being empathetic towards it. Some scenarios they have to sell. Other scenarios, you know, they want to sell. But that's great insight.
Yeah, it's interesting. And then the last thing I'll say about the paper is we also did a sort of deep dive into understanding, well, two things. A big takeaway was they see real estate as a badge. And so while we're not in an era where we have, you know, conspicuous consumption like we really did in the 80s and 90s, people approach their home more about lifestyle and the benefits for their family and, again, emotion. But they still see their home as a way to reflect their level of success. And so it's a way that they can show the people in their sphere their success, but also that can judge others too. And so there's an aspect of that which I thought was kind of interesting. And then we also looked a little bit about how around the globe, how much of your real estate, how much of your overall portfolio is held in real estate. And we see that that changes market to market around the world too, which is was a surprise to me. So for example, domestically, in North America, we combined all of North America, we see that about 24% of someone's current assets are in real estate. But in Europe, it's 53%, so it's double. I think there's a lot of reasons for that. We see more inherited income in Europe versus in North America. We see real estate being passed down over generations a little bit more in Europe, but also, you know, their homes are worth a larger percentage of their portfolio. And I think when you understand that, you understand how important that decision is to people too. If it's half of your overall holdings, that's a big deal.
Now, it's a huge deal. It's a huge deal. So talk to me specifically about North America, you know, U.S., a lot of listenership in U.S. and some in Canada. But as far as what markets are hotter, what markets are colder, and you can speak, you know, East Coast, West Coast, or specifically by, you know, state or city, whatever, you know, comes to mind as far as data. But what are you seeing as far as markets that are, you know, a little bit more seller friendly and markets that are definitely buyer's markets
in
North America?
Yeah. This is, again, we could do an hour just on this, but 2018 has been an interesting year because I describe it as sort of a tale of two markets. It's very hot in some areas and very cool in others. And there's a lot of factors for that. I think we're seeing prices generally up across the board, but we're seeing the positive and negative impact of tax reform. And that's impacting markets. So, for example, I'll just take, you know, New York and the New York metro area. And, you know, it's been a tough year, and we hear a lot about it in the media related to New York, but the numbers are the numbers, right? So Manhattan, in fact, is down, you know, it's the worst quarter since the financial crisis. They're down about 5%. Their total sales are down, you know, almost 20%. And a big part of that is, you know, inventory. They have a lot of supply, particularly in Manhattan. You know, they really built up to try to appeal to the foreign buyers and post the financial crisis. But it's also just the tax changes and the fact that owning a home, say in Westchester County, which is where the nation's highest property taxes are, owning a home there has simply become more expensive. It's not that they can't afford it, but it's become more expensive. And so we're seeing inventory up, we're seeing, you know, sales down, and that area is hit. I think there's also one other factor, which is the stock market. And it's just been a volatile stock market year. And I think anytime you see, you know, dramatic changes in the stock market, it affects the psyche of the New York metro marketplace because there's so many people that are that work in that field in that area. So, you know, I always say it's circular. Manhattan, it's New York. It'll come back. There's no question. But it's been a rougher time this year for New York. But then you counter that with Florida, which is seeing the opposite, right? So we've seen tax law changes that hurt markets that are high tax markets and high real estate tax markets, but they also help places like Florida, which has no income tax and, you know, in some cases, lower real estate taxes. And so we're seeing markets like Sarasota or the southwest of Florida, which is a higher value market if you're going to move to Florida, really being up. You know, Southwest Florida, their luxury home sales were the highest they've been in at least a decade, and they were up 25% from 2017. So
25%, that's awesome.
You got it. Yeah. So it's, you know, when you say how's the market, and people clearly always ask us that, and it's like, well, depends. you know, Texas and Colorado are both real hot spots, and they're great. And then, of course, there's the California story. We saw in 18, seven markets, mostly in Northern California, but had double-digit price growth. You know, areas like Marin, you know, maybe San Luis Obispo, Sonoma, where you'd expect it, but also areas like Sacramento, which are a little outside of the coast of California, California, And there are areas that people that can't afford the Bay Area are now moving to Sacramento. And so it's been a great year in Sacramento. Nationally, we see that $1 million-plus sales are up actually 13% year over year. So.
Oh, that's great. So you're seeing so far about 13% increase in $1 million properties this
mm-hmm.
year.
Yeah, and prices are up about 5%. So,
oh, that's great.
You know, despite all of the news and all of the New mm-hmm. York news, you know, things mm-hmm. are, I'm feeling kind of good about the future.
Good. That's great. And, progressing to 2019, you're still seeing that trend? No indications otherwise?
Not really. I mean, I think I always like to look at, again, the psyche. And if you always fall back to the data, and we know that the affluent consumer is continuing to get wealthier and that they love real estate, you know, I don't see any reason why we should, you know, I think we've protected ourselves, you know, hopefully from, you know, like a 2018, and we've gotten a lot smarter and we've done things differently. And so we're bullish on, you know, the coming year too.
That's great. Well, if somebody wanted to find out a little bit more about leading real estate companies world or luxury portfolio, I mean, is the website the best place, or what do you recommend there?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I would check out leadingre.com because that's the parent company, and there's a lot of information there. There's a section about, I think, you know, how to join or more information about that. And the same with Luxury Portfolio. And, you know, we've got a great team. We're based in Chicago and a great team that's always really responsive to questions that come in through the site. We're, you know, like I said, we have multiple members in a market. Most markets, we already have multiple members, and we're a little bit more saturated. Most of our growth is coming from outside the U.S. these days, and that's really where, in the 12 years that I've been with the company, where our focus has been in terms of growth. But domestically, you know, there's still pockets, and, you know, just you do have to be a brokerage and, you know, in the top five in terms of market share in a market, too. So that we tend to turn away about 80% of the people who apply because that's a pretty high bar. But
yeah. Well, that's good. Raising the bar. So I really appreciate your time, your insights. And then for those listeners, we'll include a link directly to the site where you can register to download the white paper that Stephanie referenced. Again, luxuryportfolio.com. You scroll down, you'll see an image of the white paper and click over, and then you can leave your information. So thanks for letting our listeners know about that resource.
Of course. I really appreciate you having me. It's fun to talk about this, and it's always a nice opportunity to, you know, share a little bit about what we're doing. So always happy to do this. Thank you.
Well, you're absolutely welcome. Thank you for your time. I know you're very busy. And that concludes today's interview. Just a reminder, if you have any questions, if you have a suggestion, please send us an email, michael@marketingluxurygroup.com, michael@marketingluxurygroup. We do have a couple live certification trainings coming up. If that's something you're interested in, reach out to us, or 2019 with spring conferences. By all means, shoot us over an email, and we'd be glad to respond. If you're interested in our free resource that we give to listeners, text the word LUX to 72,000. Text the word LUX, L-U-X-E, to 72,000, and you'll get access to our ultimate listing blueprint, our video checklist, and our three-part video series. So we're signing off. If you have any questions, like I said, send us an email, and have an awesome day, and make somebody else's day. Take care.